Thank you, Mike, and thank you all. Generally speaking, doing public programming and curation, I don't enjoy necessarily public adulation, but it is appreciated nonetheless. You have stumbled in, or by your own accord, have come to the program tonight, and it's the fourth of our Salon Series programs on local music. And we thought, we started with Moravian music a few months ago, and then we did one on kind of roots music and bluegrass here with some local performances, and then we did one last month in honor of the 70th anniversary of the Winston-Salem Symphony. That was a panel discussion. So I thought, in doing this, normally our themes, our thematic Salon Series are quarterly, but given the holidays, this quarter turned into a semi-annual theme, and we're doing four. And what better way to end that the history of music in this city with bringing it up to the present and see what's going on today and how music is playing a role, not just in the performance and the kind of the literal aspect of music, but how music is playing a role in science, research, and medicine, and all things that this town has now become known for. So thank you for being here for that. Just although I won't be here to man the ship for future programs, there are a few things that I have worked on that are coming up and that will still be going forward. Our next Salon Series theme for the first quarter of 2017 is on local ecology and how we interact with green space and kind of what's going on today historically in Winston-Salem. In that regard, that'll be January, February, March of next year. And our next program overall, and the last one of 2016, will be on December 8th here, and that is with Project Reentry, which is a local nonprofit organization that works with convicts, former convicts, and helping them adjust to life before getting released and afterwards. And that is in coordination with us hosting an exhibition, a Wake Forest undergraduate exhibition that was done a couple of years ago called Release from Stigma to Acceptance. So that'll be on display here from December through March next year as well. And there'll be related programming along with that. So, but not to adieu is the only format that I ever use that word. So without further ado, I want to introduce Dr. Jonathan Burdette. He's a professor of neuroradiology at Wake Forest Baptist Medical Center and co-founder of the Laboratory of Complex Brain Networks. In addition to being a clinical neuroradiologist, he has studied the brain using functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMR. Any of you ever been in the tube that makes a lot of noise? That's the make sure you don't have any metal on you. I would Google those images or those videos of people getting metal near an MRI. It's quite interesting. Hopefully they're not wearing it at the time. But anyway, he's an avid supporter of the local music scene, currently serving on the board of directors of the Piedmont Opera, previously serving on the board of the Winston-Salem Symphony, and currently learning all he can about American music from Western North Carolina. His daughters are here, actually, tonight. Two of them, I see, are the local bluegrass, Celtic, and rock group, the Dan River Girls, which many of you may have seen around town. So I want to welcome Dr. Burdette, and thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. I probably don't need this, but I'll wear it anyway.
Check, check.
All right, just a little more volume. Yeah, it's my great pleasure to be here talking to you about music at the end of this Salon Series on music. When you guys contacted me, I was very excited to do this. I like to speak to the public about music, one of my great passions. And so let's get started. Again, you said that I was the Laboratory for Complex Brain Networks. So half my life is as a clinical neuroradiologist. That's what I did today, reading MRIs and CT scans. But half my life is also in the Laboratory for Complex Brain Networks, which is a lot of fun, where we look at the effects mostly of lifestyle interventions like exercise, food, and music, things like that, on healthy aging. So with that, let's jump in. Let's see if technology works. I'm not a big fan of technology, but it does. Let's go here. All right, it does. Now, does that immediately mean anything? It's memorized.
Yeah.
Is it live or is it memorized? I show this around my lab. The people who are 30 and under, no idea. Absolutely no idea. I like this picture that I had my colleague draw because he's a good drawer. because it just shows music's a powerful force. We know that. But if you really start digging deeper into why that is and what does that even mean, it's very exciting. And we look at it from a neurologic perspective, but we all know it's a powerful force. It moves us. It moves us to cry. It moves us to anger. We like things. We don't like things. And it's a powerful emotional force. And I just want to tell a quick story. My little Dan River girls go to the Isle of Skye. In Scotland, at least the last 4 years, looks like it's going to be 5 years now, to train with Alistair Fraser. Now, I don't know if you know him. He is a force of nature himself, but we've had a lot of deep talks about music, and he gave up a career in petroleum industry to be a musician. He was doing the towel one night, but he's been on this crusade to try to get people to learn their own inner voice through music. But it can be dangerous, he said. It can be absolutely dangerous for yourself, but also for society. You get some musicians together and they start playing music, you never know what's going to happen. There could be a revolution. And in Scotland, specifically, we were just reading about this. He loves to tell this story. There was a bit, sort of an evangelical movement through the 1700s, early 1800s. They got rid of the bagpipes in Scotland because they're a little bit dangerous. But then everybody started playing the fiddle. They realize you get too many people playing the fiddle, that could lead to a revolution. People start getting thoughts in their head. So they got all the fiddles in the Isle of Skye and burned them. Which, you know, that if you're in charge, that's a good way to kind of suppress the masses, is to get rid of their music. I love that story. If ever a time for music were needed, I believe it's now. All right, I'm going to show you some pictures. Now, you will have an emotional connection to some of these people, and it's like nothing else in your life. Some more so than others. You'll like some, you don't like some. I trained medical school in Memphis. B.B. King means a lot to me. Jamie Albright is the head of Piedmont Operas here. To me, he's still the greatest. I just like him. I like Pavarotti. I love Elvis Presley, too. He died recently, this year, and that just was devastating to lots of people, including myself. Why is that? Dan River girls. Yeah. You know them. That means a lot to me. Max Robb, my youngest daughter's favorite, probably one of her favorite singers, a sort of cabaret singer in Berlin. All these things conjure up deep emotions, and we have preferences toward one or another, but whatever it is, we kind of take it seriously. And I'll show you later how we've actually imaged what it means to have a certain preference. All right, so let's jump on in. If you're going to have a graduation, will there be music? Will there be music graduation? All right. At most services, is there music? Yeah. Is there a music service? All right. A wedding? Is music? Oh, there'll be a certain type of music often at the wedding, but afterwards, there'll be a different type of music, but there'll be music. The Super Bowl, will there be music there? Absolutely. What are people only remember a few, you know, 2 months later? It's the halftime show. To me, if it matters, it'll have music. And you just think about anything in your life, at any event, if it really matters, it'll have music. At a funeral, will there be music? Absolutely, because it takes you deeper. If anybody got to see Tosca recently, you're talking about heightened emotions. I mean, that's the beauty of music. It can take you places you've never been. So again, powerful, powerful music. Why is that? I study from the brain. I started this a long time ago. It's amazing. It didn't seem like a long time ago, but it was, like early 2000s, where we started studying conductors, because conductors are a little bit strange. Isn't that right, Jamie? They're a little bit different beasts, and so I was a different scientist back then, so I'm not going to dwell on this. But we did get in the New York Times, which is kind of cool, we show that conductors possess auditory, they can process auditory cues better than non-musicians do. Of course they do. I mean, it's not a lot of rocket science there, but they liked it, whatever. Again, don't dwell on it, but I was interested back then in trying to get into this a little bit. But since that time, we started looking at things differently. We look at the brain more as a complex system. This is a beehive. It's a complex system. If it gets too hot, they fan their wings. If it gets too cold, they all huddle together. It's a very adaptable system. Many things are complex systems. The stock market's a complex system. The electorate of our country is a complex system. It has emergent qualities. The brain is a complex system. And so that's how we're kind of looking at things today. So how does the brain work? Now, I'm showing this slide. Sometimes when I show this slide, I offend someone. And I do not mean to offend anyone about this. I see a nurse, a former nurse scientist. But in science, there are reductionistic methods, the scientific method, to kind of isolate causes of phenomena. And pushing against that is more of a complex, let's look at the whole system and see how it works. Now, there are many people actually at Wake Forest, and colleagues, many of them, who listen to single neurons and infer scientific truth based on these single neurons. We used to do that a bit more, and even with functional MRI, we were looking at little dots in the head and trying to find this area does this, this area does that. We do that, my lab does that less now. We're a laboratory for complex brain networks. Now, I will give a quote from Barabashi, so don't get mad at me. Barabashi said, he's a very famous scientist, way more famous than I could ever dream of, who said, the more we learn about the single neuron in the brain, the less we know about the complex emergent qualities of the brain, like consciousness, perception, memories, and this kind of stuff. That's a controversial statement. I didn't say it. He said it. And there's no question we learn a ton about the brain from reductionistic methods. There's no question. We still are. But we are taking a slightly different view. And I'll talk about that. Now, Sir Francis Bacon, one of the early developers of the scientific method, his whole viewpoint was we need to isolate the independent cause of some phenomena, and that's a great thing to do. It works very well in Newtonian systems. It does not work as well in complex systems. Complex systems work more like this. There's lots of different interacting causes that lead to a certain effect. In fact, you can have the exact same causes with slightly different initial conditions and get a totally different effect. And so we're trying to do this in our way, to look at the brain more as a complex system. Brain-body interactions and all this kind of stuff. So, as always, who explains this best? Artists do. And so I'm going to show you a little bit of the work of Ursus Verli. Verli, this is his name right here, Ursus Verli. If you want to have a good 30 minutes, 20 minutes, I guess 18 minutes, go to his TED Talk, Ursus Verli. You will laugh. He's a funny human being. I'm not even sure what he is. He acts in sort of little vaudeville type things. He's sort of a comedian, but no one knows what he's up to. But he's Swiss, and he believes part of his shtick is that Swiss people are very clean. We're very precise. We don't like things like this. What is that? I don't understand it. We must clean it up. And he uses Alf Reumann, German. So he cleans it up. He takes it all apart. He says, then don't you feel better? It's all cleaned up now. I understand it. All the straight bits are here. It's just cleaned up. He also took Kandinsky's Roten Fleck, the red spot. He says, in his old TED Talk, what does that mean? I can't understand any of that. Let's clean that up. And he actually has a patent. He's Swiss. He has a patent on a whole technique of doing this, and I'm not making that up. I'm not making that up. And so he likes to clean it up. And I think it's very funny. He's cleaned up nature. So now that's weird. I mean, how can you understand that? Oh, it feels a lot better. You can count these. You can weigh them. He's cleaned up big projects. He's cleaned up parking lots. I can tell you, this is what we do in science. And we take portions of the brain and we clean it up. Now, the whole thing, but we're trying to think bigger than that and not clean it up and try to look at the whole thing. Let's look at the whole Picasso thing rather than just little bits of it. It's hard to do. It's very hard to do. Now, all these emergent complex behaviors, memory, consciousness, perception, awareness, all these sorts of things occur because of interacting neurons that are dancing together. And so
let me see here, musical experiences, or it's a complex phenomenon too. And if you've ever been to a live performance, I feel like I do that almost every night around here. Give the performers energy, because they will give you more back. And that means if you're at the opera recently, if someone just laid it up there on the line, you scream for them. Mm-hmm. And I guarantee you they're going to give you more back. It's just that you feed on each other. And it's a complex experience. Now, I like to show this phenomenon to kind of illustrate it again, to prove that there's not a single neuron in the brain that recognizes the grayness of something, that it's actually a complex interaction. The A square and the B square are the same color, the exact same shape. Now, you're like, no, that's not true. You can't do that. I'll tell you, it's exactly the same shape. If you don't believe me, you can go to the internet and look at it. But we've done this. You can actually put your hand up. You can, if you look at that versus that, I'm telling you, it's exactly the same shape. But your brain won't let you see that because we have expectations. We have all these things. There's a fake shadow there. We know that these are black and white, but he's messing with the shades of them all. We think they're all the same, so that A and B are different. But actually, they're exactly the same. We actually recreated this in the lab. And live, you can actually make it happen. But your brain will not let you tell you that those are the same. My point is, there's not a neuron in the brain that shows that gray color. It's this interacting phenomenon. This is my favorite one of these examples of the McGurk effect, which some of you neuroscientists know about. But if you go ahead and click on that, and it should run. We'll see if this works. This high-tech computer is far away.
Ha.
What? Do you look at this closely? Ha. Tell me what syllable you hear.
Ha. Pa.
Look at it closely.
Pa. Pa. Pa.
What do you hear?
Pa.
Ka.
Pa.
Pa.
Look at it closely.
Pa.
It's ta.
Pa.
I hear ta. Now close your eyes.
Pa. 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 Pa.
Open your eyes, close your eyes, open your eyes, close your eyes. I'm not doing anything. I promise.
Pa. Pa. Pa.
It changes, right?
Pa.
It changes. For me, it's very clearly, pa. I cannot make her not say ta.
Pa.
When you close your eyes, it's pop.
Pa.
I can actually go for it. That's the McGurk effect. It's very famous. But she's actually, the audio is pa. That's what, we close your eyes, you hear pa. She's actually saying ka. And you perceive ta. Most people do. About 80%. She's ta. My point of that is that the perception of what we hear and everything is complex. I mean, it's all these interacting bits. There's not a pa area of the brain. My point. So how does it work? Once again, I go to nature. And so you'll have to push the play button on this. This is a beautiful depiction of, I think, of how the brain works. It's kind of abstract. Two girls on a river in Ireland. Understand how a complex system works. You cannot just focus on an individual. A starling, it turns out, obeys three simple rules. That's what most people do. Three simple rules. You follow your neighbor. You get as close as you can, but not too close. And that's what they're all obeying. And so they're affected by his little neighbors there, who are also affected by their neighbors. And you get this bizarre, complex interaction, and you get these emergent properties where they can tie knots and untie knots and do all these kind of amazing things. That is an emergent phenomenon. And so to understand how they do that, you cannot focus on one starling. The key, we think, are relationships. Is how is this individual starling, individual person, individual neuron in the head, what are their relationships with all the other ones, and how are they applying? And it's these connections that we think are major players in how that all interacts. It's how the stock market works. That's how everything is. That's how Facebook works. I mean, it's all the same sort of thing. So we really do believe in the relationships. Now, networks and network science is this huge field that is exploding now because of social networks, computer networks. But it's exploding into brain research as well now. I'll show a couple of networks just because I think they're cool. This is, can you get that arrow off of there? It drives me crazy. This one's going to drive me crazy. It's the OCD. All right, so this is a beautiful depiction of a Caribbean reef society. Each little node is a species. Each little interaction is predator-prey. The ones on the bottom are plankton, the ones on top are the sharks. And you can imagine, if you're studying that reef, you lose one of these species, it has a percolating effect through the whole thing. Here's another one. Does anybody know what that is? That is, Bill Cheswick did this 10 years, maybe, at least ago. It looks like outer space to me. It's really cool. That is the internet, about 10 years ago. Not the World Wide Web, the actual internet, like computers connected to another computer. That's what it looks like. It has its own complex behavior. That's Facebook, a little while ago. All these connections. I could have shown, I don't think I have it. Next one, I sometimes show it, the airline industry. It looks just like this. It's exactly the same. But you can use some interesting mathematics stuff to actually study these networks and what happens and what about hubs. You know, if you've been stuck in airports that are certain hubs that one pilot not sick or, you know, been flying too long, it percolates through the system. And it has interesting emergent properties. This is my favorite network. My kids have seen me give this talk. But this is a high school sexual network in the Midwest. 600 people, over 18 months. Appropriately male to blue, and females are pink. Okay. Half the people are in one network. And there's some real superstars in here. Interesting stuff here. But all sorts of cool stuff there. You can imagine if you're interested in sex education, vaccinations, and all sorts of stuff, it'd be nice to know about such things. And of course, there was me in high school. All right, there you go. There you go. All right, here's another network. You wouldn't know what this is. This is the brain. If areas of the brain are kind of in sync with each other, and it's pretty crude right now, I'll freely admit that our techniques are not so good. But if they are in sync using fMRI, you can draw a line and link certain areas of the brain. This is what the brain looks like. I would argue it looks a wee bit like some of these starlings and things like that, these murmurations. It's kind of cool. You can actually put it back into brain space. And anyway, these are baby steps toward understanding all these cool emergent properties. This is my theory. So here we go. This is a network of the brain. And we can do this now. Now, this was very controversial in 2007, roughly, when we had the very first symposium at human brain mapping. We led that with my colleague Paul Arienti. And we had to beg and plead to actually do it. Now there's probably 5 to 10 journals on network science imaging, and traditional fMRI is dead. It's completely dead. So everyone, if you're not doing this now, you are in my field. And so everyone's doing this. It's very crude, I would argue, but at least some baby steps. So let's get back to music. That's enough about strength. Again, powerful force. And we study, like the study I'm going to talk to you about is about preference. Like I showed you pictures of John Lennon and people like that, or Pavarotti, and you'll have some preference toward it. Do you like it or do you not like it? You know if you like it and you know if you don't like it. How do you study that? So we set out to do that. And this was the highlight of my career. My institution couldn't go less. But this, we made the front page of Nature for 48 hours, which is pretty cool. Saying, I thought it was going to work. How your favorite song affects your brain. And turns out if you publish stuff in music, people like it. And even if the highest don't quite get it. We had people listen to 5 different types of music in the scanner. Just sit there and listen to it. We had them listen to rock, Kiss, I Want to Rock and Roll All Night, and Party Every Day. Yeah. Classical, the first 5 minutes of Beethoven's 5th Symphony. Country was Brad Paisley's Water, if you're familiar with country. I did a little bit. I would not like this. I don't dislike it, but I don't like it. Rap, we had Usher. We had him singing OMG. And then we had something that's unfamiliar to most Western ears, which was Chinese opera, which is pretty unfamiliar to most Western ears, certainly mine. We also had each person, there were 22 people in this, we had each person tell us if they could listen to one thing, what books their book, if they could listen to one thing in the scanner for 5 minutes, what would it be? And you would not believe the difference in stuff. We had Eminem, we had the Beatles, we had Edith Piaf, we had Rachmaninoff, Second Piano Concerto, we had the ending of Mahler's 2nd Symphony, but it had to be Simon Rattle, Birmingham. I mean, people are very specific on this thing. And so they listened to all 5 of these things, plus their favorite piece. And we looked at their brains. Now, there's a lot of different ways to look at networks in the brain. People are still fighting over this, and they'll be fighting forever. But this happens to be hub maps, the areas of the brain that are the Googles of the brain when they're listening to different things. Which areas were more connected, which one had the most connections. And you can set some thresholds, and there's some kind of interesting findings here. I don't know how to interpret them, but they're interesting. Just in classical law, these areas right here, the auditory-ish areas of the brain, were the most consistently and most highly connected, which I thought was kind of interesting. If you using some statistical analyses, it turned out that classical and rap were the most similar. Which I thought was kind of very interesting on some levels. But that's not really what we were more interested in, preference, if you like something or not. So they had to rate in the scanner from 1 to 10 how much they liked and didn't like. And strangely enough, you would think that everyone's greatest dislike would have been the Chinese opera, the unfamiliar. But it wasn't, absolutely wasn't. Less than half the people, that was their least favorite. So this is looking at things differently. This is whether or not the one you like the most versus the one you dislike the most. Not the one you pick, not your favorite, but of those 5, which one you like the most versus dislike. This is a hub map again, the degree. How connected are you? Are you Google? Are you the socialite who knows everybody? It turns out, this is looking from the side of the head, looking right at the midline of the brain. This area back here, precuneus, posterior cingulate, doesn't matter what you're, but it looks quite similar. Actually, it looks very similar, and statistically now we have developed some new techniques, you actually can look at it. They are very similar. Okay, that's kind of not exciting. But then we looked at the path length, which is 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. How long does it take till you get from this part of the brain to that part of the brain? Well, it takes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 based on your network. I don't know if you ever played 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, but you know, you say you acted this movie, you acted with this, you acted this, you acted with Kevin Bacon. Can you get there in 6 degrees? But it turns out there was a big difference between the like and the dislike of path length. For the like, this being red means that it was highly connected to the whole brain. Very few steps, it could reach the whole brain. If you dislike, this area was not. So then, using some kind of cool new technique, you said we're gonna look really closely at this area, which is in the middle, probably the hub, is pretty much the hub of the brain, of what they call the default mode network, which doesn't matter, except it's an extremely important system of connections in the brain. So this is looking at like versus dislike, the default mode network. Normally, if someone's lying in the scanner, doing anything, listening to someone, you'll see a default mode network that's highly connected from from this area, posterior cingulate, precuneus, that area right there. It's connected to these parietal areas and these sort of medial frontal areas. That's what we got in the light. That is absolutely not what we got in the dislight. No, we do a lot of stuff. On old people, we see alteration of the fault network, or exercise improves it, all these kind of different things. We have never seen anything like this. Where if you dislike a piece of music, your precuneus posterior cingulate is talking to itself. This is what this means. It is only talking to itself. It does not care about the frontal lobes. Now this network, people philosophize on what it is about. It's probably sort of your self-referential thoughts, your place in the world, sort of network, if you will. You can philosophize forever on exactly what this network is about. You can imagine that when it's just sitting there talking to itself and not communicating with your higher cognitive areas and other things like that, it's a totally different experience. Well, you know it's a different experience if you don't like something versus if you like it. But we're the first ever to show that there really is sort of your brain is behaving differently when that is going on. And it's kind of, I think that's kind of interesting. But what about your favorite? What about your absolute, the favorite thing? Well, we know that's a different experience. Yeah, I like something. I can tolerate my daughter Jessie. She likes that modern rock and roll. the pop music today. It's not my favorite, but I kind of like it. I have a little soft spot for kind of just sugary pop music. I wouldn't say it's my favorite, but I like it. That's over here. But your favorite, the one you picked to listen in the scanner for 5 minutes, because at your wedding you heard this. You have some deep memory, emotional connection to it. How's that different? Well, this is looking at a different community. This is the auditory-ish community here in the temporal lobes. If you look at the light here, in the same community, by community I mean you're talking to these other areas of the brain more than other areas of the brain. They're in your community, and you can actually prove that. This thing, auditory, is talking to the hippocampus. They're in the same community, which is very interesting. We see this in other things as well. They're in the same community. On your favorite, they're absolutely not. The hippocampus is all by itself in its own community. That's kind of interesting. Now you can philosophize on why that is. Now the hippocampus, what is it for? It's Michelle McCullough, then. The hippocampus is known to help us encode memories, encode all sorts of emotional stuff like that. And you could argue, we did argue in our paper, that if something is your favorite piece, you're not encoding memories for that. It's there. It's deep seated in sort of a. It's hard to describe. You could describe it as well as I do, but there's emotional memory, all these things. It's there, and it's like you've placed it in a different plane. In your sort of a brain realm, if you will, versus if you like something, where you're bouncing back and forth through hippocampus. I find that extremely interesting. This has big time implications in my next topic, which will be harnessing the power of music in medicine. I think it is. So music is medicine. You can thank my buddy Paul Arianti for drawing this thing, because say, Paul, draw me stuff on music is medicine. And he'll do it on his iPad. But I was at a conference 2 weeks ago at Salem Town, sponsored by Wake Forest, where the people from all over came in around the country, called Exercise in Medicine. And it was all about movement and all these kind of things, which is another thing I'm very interested in. You should move. It is super important to get up and move. But the theme of that conference was, it's not exercise in medicine, exercise is medicine. Everybody's like, oh yeah, exercise is medicine. And we all stood up, yay. So I was trying to think music and medicine. Music is medicine. I mean, there's no question about that. And I'll show you a few examples of that in some lucky places I've got to go to actually witness some of this. I'm not a music therapist myself, but I know a bunch of them. So I'll talk a little bit about how music's way more powerful than a pill. And a lot of that's because of neuroplasticity. There's just a concept that, the brain is plastic. It can change, even through aging. You have experiences, which changes your brain, which changes your brain wiring, which gives you different experiences. It's a dynamic system, and it's absolutely plastic. And music plays on that. No problem. I got to speak at the first World Congress of Clinical Neuromusicology. That's a big lot of words, but it's exactly what it says. Music's effect on the brain in the clinic is basically what it is. It was in Salzburg, of course. But the cool thing was, so I got to speak about brain and networks. No one was doing this at the time. So we were kind of ahead of our time with that. But all these talks over here, mostly by German people, was all about neurorehabilitation. And I saw the most amazing videos of people who were, let's say a Parkinson patient who's kind of locked in. They can't get going. And you start playing beats to it. It's like, boom, 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 boom. Then you take it off. They can't go. What is that all about? What is that rhythmic entrainment that allows you to do that? There's a guy, Michael Tout, who's now in Toronto, who's kind of the expert in the world on rhythmic entrainment. And how important that is in our lives. And if you've ever played with people who can't do that, playing music, it's a pain. Or what it means to even be in the groove and all that kind of stuff. But it can be used clinically, and people use that. They use the beats to help people. But there's all sorts of other things, melodic therapy as well. The other great conference I got to get to in Dusseldorf was Gehirn und Welt, the brain in the world. But the cool thing about that was I got to visit an actual rehabilitation facility. Now let's just say it doesn't look like the rehabilitation facilities that most of the ones in the United States. I would want to live at this place, it's unbelievable. These people, they have different levels of neurologic dysfunction from people who've had bad strokes, bad car accidents, all sorts of stuff. Brain tumors that have been cut out. I mean, there's a whole hospital full of these people. And they have different levels, and they incentivize people to get to the next level, because you get to the highest level, you get to go to the cafeteria on your own, all sorts of stuff like that. But you notice, they do everything. You notice just, if you get to walk out here, which you want to, because it's nice, the sidewalk changes texture. There's different levels of difficulty, let's just say, in just walking, and they push people to kind of try to get comfortable with all this. You notice, of course, there's green all over the roof. I mean, it's a full yard on the roof. Well, of course, it saves energy. But I like to zoom in. You notice the windows are open, and it's all light. There's a man there who's had a stroke. He's hanging from the ceiling in a harness. There's a therapist right there working with him. But one of the coolest things about this whole place was every single day they had music. And they had dance, which I think is very closely linked body movements with music, and also a very powerful intervention, which some people do here. Every single day. And how? That is a little bit, most places in the United States don't do that, though some are starting to. Even in British Children's Hospital, we have drummers now, and we have musicians coming in. And it's not only just a huge positive effect, there's a social effect, getting people together, but a stimulation of the brain effect. I would see classes here where they're just sitting there, and there's people who just couldn't do it, but they tried so hard just to keep the beat. You could see they were happy and just trying to hang on. And they get better. They absolutely get better. So that's a cool place. Some of you may have seen the documentary A Life Inside. It was shown here, I believe, at Aperture. It is really neat if you haven't. It's mostly about Alzheimer's patients who, they have amazing videos online. If you watch it, they kind of seem not there, let's just say. Just keep it simple. They just kind of are existing. You put on these headphones and they come to life. It's like, it's usually songs from their teenage years, early 20s, and it's like, I mean, you just see it, it's like joy. And it's like they're connecting to something deep. And there's also this memory and music foundation now. It has several thousand licensed places. Winston-Salem has a few now, where they're giving out iPods and all this to elderly people. It's pretty awesome, actually, and I totally believe in it, that if you expose elderly people to music, they will do better, and they will have a happier life, and kind of come out of dementia sometimes. You can just see it. They're alive inside, and it's really neat. I like to put this up there because you are I'm sure remember when Gabby Giffords, the congresswoman from Arizona, was shot in the head. Pretty horrible thing, as we all know. There she is trying to learn to read. She looks frustrated. She, in kind of a weird coincidence of fate, Shona and I actually got to meet her husband and her, and I spoke to him about this because ABC News had a special on her. She was struggling to read. I mean, struggling to speak. This, I don't, Gabby Giffords was a vivacious tour de force before she was young. Still is a bit. She could not speak. And they were trying everything. She's got the best care you could ever imagine in Houston. And could not. Everything they tried, they could not do it. So, they hired a music therapist. She can speak now. There she is. She liked singing growing up. And so they said, we'll try that. Well, she spoke in Winston-Salem about a year ago with her husband. It's sort of sing-songy, but it's speaking. She's communicating. And why is that? How is she able to do that? They work, and can't get anything done. They go to music, and pretty quickly, she's able to learn how to speak again. I believe, and it's pretty clear to me, that if you just look at the activation of the brain when you listen to music, just the activation, it's on fire. It's activating so many different types of circuits, from perceptual circuits, visual, auditory type stuff, to memories, cognition, emotions. The brain is on fire. So if you injure your brain and you can no longer perform some function, it makes a lot of sense to me to use the tool that activates so many different circuits. Maybe we can have some neuroplasticity going on and kick into and use some of these other circuits. It clearly works. And she's a different person today because of music therapy. Again, I just want to emphasize the social aspect too, just getting around and banging drums. Maybe some of you might have seen the Winston-Salem monthly magazine this month, the one that just came out. It showed, there's Margie Sharp, Paul Sharp, sorry. Margie Sharp, music therapist at the Center for Cognitive Rehabilitation, somewhere out in the mall. Is that right? Yeah, where they're using music therapy. She's using melodic intonation therapy here to help a stroke patient learn how to speak again. And it works. There's not a pill here either. There's nothing you can do to help someone like that, except for this. And I saw a video in Salzburg where there's a woman. The great thing about music therapy, I like it, is that it's a one-on-one thing. So you're looking at someone, and you're trying to figure out what can we do that actually touches them. And once they figure it out, you just go with it. And there was a woman who happened to grow up playing some piano, and she had a stroke, and she had total neglect of this whole space, just total neglect. It's like it didn't exist. It didn't exist. And they some clever music therapists said, aha, she used to play the piano. So they forced her to start on scales. You know, they'd go da 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 da. And just sit there, and would just kind of eat at her. And she'd had a bad stroke. I'm telling you, a bad stroke. And would just eat at her. And she would just try to figure it out. Well, that da is in this area of neglect. That they made sure that, and over time through that, she was able to learn that there is a space over here. And again, I mean. It's like it was like this cognitive dissonance in her head. Like, I know there's notes up there that I need to be playing, and over time she was able to do that. Again, just another example of music medicine. So I just want to come back to music is a powerful force. Somebody asked her, it really is. Is it live or is it Memorex? You know this, you're here. I mean, I appreciate your coming here. That obviously music probably plays a role in your life. It plays a role in everyone's life. Any child, your child was up here earlier. I asked her, I said, do you like music? Oh yeah. I mean, we had a little moment there where it was like, heck yeah, I like music. I mean, kids like music, they get it, they'll dance to it. The first thing that they sort of emote about, they beat it out of them, that you're not supposed to do that sort of thing. But, it is a powerful force from your, and Michael Tout, the guy I was telling you about, he gives lectures on this and how it's a fundamental language you have numeracy, you have numbers and stuff. You have what we speak and sort of letters and stuff. But we also have music. And there's decent evidence to support that music is an underpinning of all these other languages and actually predates all those other languages. And so it's sort of this primal force. And so you might as well tap into that. I want you to remember that we're starting to use some techniques in the brain that actually can show some of these things. Like if you like something versus you dislike. And so the experiences that you have, yeah, we might be able to see some of the neurologic underpinnings of that. I want you to remember about murmurations and that complexity theory and complex systems, which is every system you're in right now, behave a bit like this. There's some beautiful patterns where the actual little, in this case, little birds, little neurons, bees, stock market, little cell, all these little things interact with each other, and they affect each other, which affects the other one, which affects you, and you get these amazing emergent properties. And then we have plastic brains, and finally, music really is medicine. And that I want you, which you do already, but I want you to play music. I want you to enjoy music. I want you to support people who play music, especially in this community. And to remember that music really is medicine. And the future is now. So any questions? Any questions?
I think in the movie, The King's Speech,
yeah. It's
been a while since I saw that, but didn't they encourage the king to imagine himself singing the words?
That is correct. I, sadly, the only person in my family who's not seen The King's Speech. But they told me that that is the case. And he had problems speaking, and so they essentially are saying, let's try something different. Let's try some different pathways.
Yeah.
And it helped. It helped. And I had a friend who I sang in chorus with when I was in Ann Arbor, Michigan. He was a medicine resident, internal medicine resident. Had about the worst stutter you could ever imagine. He sang beautifully in the chorus I was in Ann Arbor. And clearly a different process. And it's fascinating to me.
I'm interested in whale song and the effects on the brain and humans, and so can you speak to that?
You speak to it for a second first. Explain.
I don't know a huge amount about it, but it seems that there's some archetypal, you know, primal things going on there.
Communication.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would have to 100% agree with that, but that we don't fully understand. They clearly are communicating, like all animals, at a very interesting level, using song or other energies, if you will. So I'm very sympathetic to that.
Wondered if you've done any kind of mapping of the brain,
no. People
listening to them.
That's interesting. Mm-hmm. Listening to whale song, I find very sort of meditative, mm-hmm. And I believe the latest thing that I'm kind of obsessed with, driving my life crazy, but is the idea of brain states, and that when you listen to certain music, you get into a brain state, or if you're meditating, you get into this point that is to achieve some sort of states that then affects all the other inputs that come in. We are studying that. We are studying things like meditation and things like that to achieve certain states that allow you then to interact with the world slightly differently. And there's no, by the way, your default mode network is altered acutely if you are, after you meditate. Mm-hmm. And so your place in the world does change. I mean, and to me, music has a very powerful role in the same sort of way where it, Deborah Heggie, my assistant for many, many years, has to deal with me. And she knows, if I'm being ridiculous, which my family has to deal with all the time, but if I'm being negative in the lab and cynical, she said, you know what? It is time for you to go listen to some music. Go play some music. When you go home tonight, get your girls to play music. Do something, because I can't deal with you like that. And it works. And that's sort of a brain state thing.
But Has there been any observations of detrimental music or detrimental sounds, things that could make a good brain go bad?
I don't
combination of not necessarily music, but just some level of sounds.
I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Nothing observed.
Yeah. It's very interesting. Just the idea of good versus bad music has been a hot topic in all of music research. The Mozart effect, for example, I'll get you listening to Mozart. I'm like, smart. That's been a little bit debunked. And part of the purpose of our research on preference was to have different styles of it. Like your favorite piece, I didn't care if it had words or didn't have words. I didn't care if it was classical or if it was rock and roll. If it's what you had a connection to. And that's very controversial in musicology and music research. That people think there's very difference in the way your brain and body respond if it has words versus not words and that and that. So our paper is a little controversial about that. I think it's very important because you probably shouldn't, if you're in music therapy, for example, why would you play Mozart to someone who that it means nothing to them, and versus that they have a personal connection to it? I happen to like Mozart, but and that might work in some music therapy with me. But so the rating something on a scale of good music versus bad music is dicey. I don't get sort of thrashing metal music, though I do think it has some operatic undertones to it, and that it's kind of big emotional stuff. But some people do, and they love it. So I don't know. The good for your brain, bad for your brain thing is very hard, I think. It's a long way to answer.
Yeah, if possible, can you go back to the slide of like and dislike music?
Got the power.
Yeah. Now, I'm going to jump in. Say, for example, when I behave in a non-racist manner, would the pattern be like? And when I behave towards you in a racist manner, would the pattern be like dislike?
Great question. I don't know the answer to that.
I have a hunch that the pattern will be replicated. I have no proof, but no evidence. But my hunch is that when I interact with other human beings in a like manner, that's how my internal...
It feels right. It feels right what you're saying.
Yes.
That this is a more interactive pattern, if you will, over there, versus a more you're stuck inside your own head.
Because I'm in the dislike mode, I'm constricting myself. I'm
I like that. Mm-hmm. I like that. Back to the first.
Would you expand on your definition of state? Because I believe that absolutely, that music is kind of a state of being, particularly if you're involved in making music.
Yeah. I think we live in certain brain states or brain body states where, and then we have inputs coming in for interactions with other people or all sorts of stuff. I'm talking to you, so there's interactions there. And I do believe that when you're in a good mood or you're in a bad mood, I mean, this is very simple, you're in a certain state. But I believe that music is one of the more powerful forces of altering that state. And, If you're in a nightclub in Las Vegas and it's just pulsating, boom, boom, gong, and they done, gong, gong, that's a certain state that you have decided you want to actually get into that state. I think Wagner is a state. My maestro Alfred, I'm not the biggest fan of Wagner. My middle daughter, who's sitting right beside him, is asking, when can we go see our next Ring cycle? Huge fan of Wagner. To me, Wagner is a state, is a brain state. That we were fortunate recently, we saw Tristan and Isolde at the Met. That's a long opera. And I think his point, actually, is just a state. Is that, that's why, it's like, and it's totally affecting you. And you lose all sense of time. And you get these, and it's amazing. If you let yourself go and listen to it, maestro, it's really amazing. And I think Ellie once described it to me as, and correct me if I'm wrong, it allows me to be who I am. I don't know what that means exactly, but I kind of like it. Wagner, that's a state to me. So I don't fully understand it, But I do know meditation, obviously, if you do it, you practice it, and you're good at it, and you achieve a different state. I mean, Michelle Kell knows more about this than I do, but the, so I think it's very important. And music, I think, really is a state-based sort of phenomenon, if that makes any sense. Though that's me just philosophizing. I mean, it's my opinion. Yeah. I know you.
You do. Hey, John. I wonder if you've done any study or you have any understanding of music, the effects of music on children with ADD or ADHD. And I've had my own experience with
it. Yeah, you've had way more experience than I have, except that I am ADHD. So and you sort of calm me down, you listen to music. But I think, I mean, you work in the school system, so I mean, she's a Montessori expert back there, but and a musician herself. But to me, it's a no-brainer, no pun intended, that you would have people doing music like all the time at school. It's a mentally taxing, physically taxing, beautiful experience. And I don't mean just sort of sitting around, as it often is in a mediocre chorus, where it's just this way. I'm talking about where they can move, physically move, and kind of get into it. If I were running a school, music and dance and drama would be extremely important. Kind of as important as those other ones. And it would absolutely help the issues, in my opinion, of ADHD. Being a card-carrying one myself, I live for recess and music class, and that's kind of sad to think about. So that's a no-brainer for me. Now, it's music, unfortunately, finds itself, like all the arts, not really on the sideline, but considered fluff, if you will. And it is in medicine too. I have tried for a long time to try to get medicine, music more into our hospital. It is there now. I mean, there are, in the neonatal intensive care unit, they've actually done studies at Baptist, at Wake Forest, where there's harp music being played, and you have tangible changes. In Germany, I know people, anesthesiologists who use music. You get out of surgery, you get headphones. Why? Well, your stress hormones go down, your cortisol levels drop, you heal faster. So they have financial reason. They get out of the ICU quicker, they go home faster. Well, that's money. And so even 10 years ago, there were some hospitals, some of these super progressive hospitals, where you would arrive and they would give you headphones and you'd plug in the wall. They only had like four or five choices, but that's to keep your stress levels down, which, guess what, everything's better. You heal faster. The guys who are the Mannheim Steamroller, is a group, right? I can't remember their manager. And rather rich people, I might add. Some of the highest selling Christmas albums of all time. Millions of dollars these guys are. But they're very interested in this, and they put systems into hospitals. And if you're a super rich hospital, like Mayo Clinic, they have several rooms like this. We actually have a room. And Chuck Tegler, who's into these sorts of things, has his own room of this. But they come in and put speakers. And they do these 4D recordings of like nature sounds. And I swear to God, you feel like you're there. Like I'm in a rainstorm now. But they believe passionately, and they have the money to do it, that music should be in every single hospital room. And it shouldn't be just kind of tinny crap music. It should be good speakers, because then it has a more visceral, literally visceral component effect on you, which then tangibly decreases your stress, etc. It is hard sell to people who wear suits to the hospital, because again, it's like it's much easier to give somebody pills, much easier to do all that kind of stuff. And I understand that, but when it saves money in the end, and that's kind of the approach that many people are starting to use. And it's coming. I mean, it's here already, but it is going to be normal within 10 years that you just go to your music therapist if you're having a neurological problem. And that's how it should be, I think.
Have you looked at anything from live music versus digital music before?
That's very interesting. No, I have not. I'm a huge fan of live music. It is a different experience. The analog world is very different. But we are analog. So I sound a bit like a Luddite talking to my young millennials who I work with. But I highly encourage live music. It's a different experience. And you physically feel stuff that you would not feel in the digital world. If you heard Jill Gardner singing Tosca, lying on the ground, you know, whatever. I mean, a human being that in an analog world can ping the back of an auditorium, that's way cooler to me than, and it feels different than listening to it. I like listening to recordings, I like that, but it's not the same. And part of it, I do think, is also, it's an interacting thing. Like I said earlier, you give back to them. And it just feeds on itself. You get some, even like good improvisers. We had some the other night. These guys could just play the heck out of bluegrass instruments. And if they sense that you're liking this, and they're gonna give you more. And then it just kind of builds on itself. Think. And next thing you know, you're at a high level. So I'm all in when it comes to live music and supporting live music and all your live music institutions in the city. It's really important, I believe.
So when you were explaining, you now think of the efficacy of music therapy, you explain it with the idea of the brain is a complex system and
right, that it's and harnessing
feedback,
tapping into other
gives you new experiences, which then you respond to, your brain rewires. Well, music therapy obviously is a field older than since 2007 when the brain was thought of as a complex system. How was the efficacy of music therapy understood prior to thinking of the brain in that way?
This is the sad part of my job. It doesn't matter what brain is, quite frankly. Does it work or not work is what matters. But I like this, just we add a little bit of science to it because it gives them a little more clout to be taken seriously. The fact is, it had worked way before anybody's doing any brain imaging. And it doesn't make it more effective because we're doing brain imaging, and that's, you know, I can admit that. Some of my colleagues won't admit that. But to me, does it work or not work? And this is icing on the cake to show there may be some neurologic underpinning to all this. So yes, it absolutely predates all this complexity stuff. And it wasn't started because of that. It's all started on just N equal one basis. Like, you have a clever music therapist who comes and sees somebody, and they figure out, and next thing you know, that person's better. Now there's a whole licensing agency, though. Now you can become a clinical music therapist. And there's several in this town now. And so this, to me, this doesn't change anything. It just adds a little more clout, perhaps, to getting it into hospitals.
Okay.
And it's interesting.
Well, then let me flip it. Do you think there is any way in which a better understanding of what is happening in the brain might change the practice of music therapy, change strategies?
In theory, I certainly say that when I write a grant. In theory, I'm a little bit cynical about stuff like that, but what I like about the field is that they don't care. Who do music therapy are passionate people, and they're going to do it. And they're gonna figure out new ways. And some people are into rhythm, some people are into melody, and they're trying different techniques on different people, and some work better than others. Michael Tout himself, who is the godfather of all this, is a rhythm guy. And we've done a study with him that we haven't looked at the data yet. We're trying to measure, which is really hard if you've been in an MRI scanner. If you've been in an MRI scanner, it's loud. It's gung, gung, gung. It's banging away, so it's kind of hard to measure rhythm. But we've done a study, we haven't analyzed yet, where we took people and they had to tap their finger to what they're hearing in a headphone. We try to eliminate the scanner noise as much as possible. It's like tap, 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 like that. And then we had a change, just a little bit, 5% difference, where it's speeding up and slowing down, where most people can't sense it. And then we had about 20% change where it was kind of speeding up, slowing down. Many people can sense that. Then we had a tap, 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 and then it conks out, and then they just have to try to keep their rhythm themselves. And we can measure all that. I think that's very interesting, because I think rhythm, which is at the root of all music, a lot of music, is its own interesting system. And it's very important clinically. and how we walk and all this other stuff and how we experience music. Again, Alistair Frazier, our buddy, he talks about the groove is special. And you know when you're in the groove and when you're not in the groove. Just because you're playing in rhythm with somebody doesn't mean you're in the groove. But what does that even mean? And then, but you can tell as an audience member, okay, that is rocking out right now. I don't know what it is. Okay, now it's not. Anyway, but yet there are professionals and it's just... And anyway, rhythm's very powerful. I don't know how did I start talking about that. You said...
might it change the practice?
I don't know. Yeah.
One of the things I noticed last year when I was a chaplain at that Baptist was...
Former neuroscientist. their own lab.
Was when you talk about stress and the effects of decreasing stress in medicine, would be that for some people, having the chaplain come in and saying a prayer, and particularly a familiar prayer that they can join in with, seems to have such beneficial effects for that person, and I'm assuming because it's decreasing stress.
Yeah.
And I think that would
it's
be
something just, they know.
It's something they know.
Yeah.
It's a familiar.
Yeah.
And there's the interaction, too. And so
right, a personal connection.
Yeah, I was very curious with your data how that would fit in.
I don't know. Uh-huh. But I totally agree with you. And any interaction, a human being, if you've ever been in a hospital, any interaction that is personal and not just clinical is huge, I think. I mean, just change, I mean, you know, I've luckily never myself been a patient very much, but the few times I was from knee surgery and stuff like that, that went bad. But I mean, the first thing I did, I'm bringing my boom boxes coming in. And if, and, I had a friend, Benjamin Ward, who, there's the music library at the School of the Arts is named for him, because as a Duke professor, he gave his entire state to the School of the Arts.
Yay!
Because he was a philosophy professor, but he loved music. And he thought the only place in the state to deserve it was the School of the Arts. So the new library there is named for him. He died of cancer. And he was sending out emails to a lot of us who knew him on the days that he went into chemotherapy. And he would write about, he's like, today it's Bill Ham Kemp playing, it's all Schubert today. It's all Schubert today on my chemo. And, you know, for several hours, I don't care what the nurse is doing, I don't care. I've got my Sennheiser headphones, and I'm just going to be focused on Schubert the entire day. And then I'm going home. And then he'd write about the experience and explain how great, in the second movement, oh, it was so amazing, always is, but oh, it's got me. And then next Friday, he would write, you know, today, it's Strauss' four last songs. And I'm taking different people with me, you know, and he would talk about Schwarzkopf versus this person versus that person. And there was no way that doing chemotherapy and stuff was, to him, it was like, whatever. You know, I'm probably going to die in the end, which he did. But just, he had music with him. And so to him, the experience of going to the hospital, Duke Hospital, wasn't that bad. And, you know, he was going through hell, but he definitely had music with him. And he wrote email after email about these experiences, and it's all through music. And, you know, it was pretty cool. So any connection you can have with a patient is huge, I think. And people are going in the hospital now, and I think it should be more, quite frankly. And it should be paid for. You should pay people to go into hospitals and connect with musically or in any way, I think. Michelle, Nicole, again.
Can I ask one more? So I worked in the neuro ICU, and what I'm noticing are younger people who are Wi-Fi connected, and they can put that phone or whatever next to the patient and play their music for that patient. That seems incredibly healing to people, and it just brings something else into that clinical space.
It's well said. I can't say any better. Perfect. And it's their music, preference again. Your preference is a different experience than just having random elevator music. I mean, it's which I would favor over no music, but.
But that comment takes me back to when you were talking about what goes on with your favorite versus something that goes on with what you like.
Right.
And the growth or connectivity on the like side, how do you figure out with the patient not what was their favorite, because that might be comforting and stress relieving perhaps,
right.
I'm not sure, But on the like side, where more is going on, and therefore
yeah, no, absolutely,
maybe better things are going on.
We argue that in our paper. Right? Maybe you don't want their favorite when you're doing that. Maybe they're too close to that somehow, and that they're not activating enough systems, or we. I don't think that's known. I mean, I know that's not known. Now, what people should, what they use in music therapy, and the super sort of I would say highly more sophisticated places they're doing, like the place I showed in Dusseldorf. I don't know what they're using, quite frankly. If it's if they're asking them, what do you want to hear today, or if it's a program that they have, I actually don't know the answer to that. But it is an interesting question because it is a different experience. We know that.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.